badly I was doing. I went behind for thousands of years. I lost the gift that we receive as Christians when we are taught that we only live once in the flesh. But I was so fooled by all of these teachings that I ended up believing reincarnation was a fact. So the Lord gave me a whole lesson about this. But to make it the story short about that part, I lost all the graces that I could have received on the dying of all the relatives, because every time someone died, to me, just reincarnated. So I despised them. I lost all this amazing grace we have, that we are a family in God, that if we believe in Christ, we don't die, you know? So actually, I lost that. So when I buried my mother, I went back to California, and a year later, I went back to Colombia to spend Christmas with my sisters. So I got there, and one of my sisters told me that she felt she was going to die soon. And the reason being is because she was ill, but also because someone was dying in our family, like I told you, like 6-7 months apart in the last 4 years. So we were all looking around to see who was next. So if someone had a bad cough, we were suspicious, that was next, you know? Little did I know that I was next, because I am here, and you're going to know at the end of the story why. I am here because of an absolute miracle. That's the only reason I'm here. So my sister asked me to go to church and pray the baby Jesus novena with her, the Christmas novena, the infant Jesus. It's an old tradition in the Catholic Church, but it's been lost in many countries. You know, I promote this worldwide now. You can see it in my website if you are interested. And I give you at the end the website, and I promote Divine Infancy, and especially the one in Christmas. It's a beautiful devotion. It reunites all the family, and especially brings the children to worship a God that is a child king. And it's a beautiful thing. In Philippines, they also practice it, and in many countries in Latin America. Unfortunately, most of the rest of the world is lost. So now, I didn't believe that in Jesus anymore. You know, I didn't believe in the church anymore, of anything like that. I couldn't care less about the church. I never went to mass. I've been away from the church for 33 years at that moment. But I went with my sister just to please her, because she was supposed to be dying, you know. So I go to church with her. And then when I went to church that day, it was the 16th of December, because it begins on the 16th, ends on the 24th at midnight, in midnight mass, when the baby Jesus is born. So I was there, and the priest introduced the novena, saying, "He who prays the novena with devotion and faith will be granted a grace by the baby Jesus." And here I am, a pagan. You know, I jump on the opportunity. I say, "How if I get something out of this?" So I asked my sister, "How miraculous is the baby?" And she gave me all kinds of testimonies. And I said, "Oh, well, so I'm going to ask the baby to change my life." But you see, the change of life I was asking from the baby Jesus is not what you're looking at right now. I had a very different plan. I asked the baby Jesus to grant me the opportunity, even though I was 47 years old, to grant me the opportunity to retire with a lot of money, and to be able to go to Indonesia, to an island that I had seen, where you can marry as many women as you can support. And that was me. That's how lost I was. I was a wreck, you know? And that's what I was asking from the baby Jesus. But I was seriously asking for that. And hoping, oh, he's so miraculous, you know, like, he's gonna do it. And my sister had no clue what I was asking for. So every day that we would go to church to pray the novena, she would go like this and say, "Do it with a lot of devotion." I said, "You bet." That's the way it was. I was just so into it, you know? And I tell you, I recommend this novena to everybody, because it's so effective. The baby Jesus, that's why I carry him. He's my boss, by the way. I carry him everywhere. He answered the novena 12 hours after I finished it. That's how effective it is. He granted me a change of life. But you probably know about God's humor, don't you? I'm going to show you the way he did it with me. I finished, as I said, at midnight on the 24th, when he's born. At midnight on the 25th, as I was driving into a ranch of one of my uncles, after I partied for 2 days, I was driving in there, 6 guys jump out of the woods, heavily armed and kidnapped me and took me captive into the jungle. So my whole change of life took place right there, you know. It began there. It was not exactly the island I was expecting to see. So they tied my hands in the back and covered my head and took me into the jungle and put me away in a cave. In that cave, it was filled with bats, and the ground was filled with the bats' excrement. And from the excrement, all kind of bugs were coming and biting me everywhere. And I can give you a horror stories about the cave, but it's not that I came here to give you a testimony about kidnapping. It's just that in that cave is where I had this mystical experience with the Lord. And then this is what happens. I was there in that cave, and the guys that kidnapped me, six guys, they were talking about another group that were supposed to come to pick me up. So they were supposed to show up the next day, but they didn't. So the conversations I was hearing was that they were going to shoot me and leave because they couldn't wait any longer. But they didn't. So every day they had the same conversation, and 15 days went by. So they got me once a day out of the cave, and they gave me something to eat, something they found somewhere, because they didn't have enough food for all those days. So they begin to bring me food from the hunt, you know. Imagine all the things they were doing there. So, and I was so desperate because I didn't have God in me. So all I wanted to do was to try to escape somehow or to die. Those were the only things that I had in my mind. Some days I would like, I just wanted to die and get it over with. And some days I was hoping to escape. That was all that was going through me. And then on the day 15, at night, early at night, the group that was to pick me up showed up. And they got me out of the cave, uncovered me. I was in terrible shape already. I could hardly stand. And then one of the guys told me he was the commandant, the commander. He was surrounded by a lot of rebels, young rebels. They were dressed up in military outfits, but I knew they weren't soldiers. And heavily armed. They looked like Pancho Villa's army, you know, like they had all kind of machine guns and little guns and big knives and grenades and all kind of stuff like that, you know. And you know that they could kill you in a second. They were real killers, you know. And they meant business. They told me I was kidnapped, like a big secret. I've been in a cave for 15 days. Like, you know, I'm going there. They tell me I have to pay them an incredible ransom. Money, you won't believe the money they were asking from me. You see, these people have seen me in TV and movies for years. So they thought I was the biggest fish. And they were asking for a lot of money. And then they show me the names of my sisters and all the information about them. And they told me if I refused to pay the money, they were going to kill my sisters one by one and show me until I begin to pay. And then they told me if I escape, they will do the same thing too. Also, they told me that the guys that kidnapped me in my hometown and brought me to them, they sold me out. It was like a business. I was being exchanged in the middle of the jungle as a commodity, you know. And then the conditions of the deal between those two people, those two groups, were that I was to be executed once I paid the ransom, because they didn't want me to go back to my hometown to set them up with the police because I had seen their faces. So that was, he sentenced me to death also. So once he did that, the guys that sold me out left. And he covered myself up again, my head, and tied me up and sent me back into the cave. He told me he was going to pick me up the next day. And a few young rebels stayed behind, guarding me from the outside of the cave. Once I fell back in that cave, I went through the most amazing, painful moment of my life. Because if you think the first 15 days were terrible, that night was horrible because there was no hope anymore. Even if I tried to escape, I couldn't because that meant killing all my family. I knew I was going to be killed in the jungle, buried in the jungle, and nobody was going to ever find me. So you know those stories when people are waiting for a lost relative forever, and their mother is thinking he's going to show up for 20 years, 30 years. I was thinking I'm going to be one of them. And it was very painful. It was horrible. And I tried to find something within me that will help me cope with such hardship. And I couldn't